What's up, everyone? I'm Helena Alamu, and welcome to another episode of the DNA Download, where we explain the science of genetics so you can live in the know. When people talk about their DNA results, I keep hearing the word haplogroups. Joining me today is Dr. Samantha Esselman, a scientist from the 23andMe ancestry team who can unpack this concept. So, Samantha, what are haplogroups? Truly, it sounds like a word my dad would make up in Scrabble.
Well, it's definitely a real word. A haplogroup is a grouping or an assignment of similar sets of patterns in people's DNA. So it's kind of like if we were to group people based on something like their zip codes.
Oh. And
then we can use these patterns of DNA to trace the ancient origins of your ancestry.
Okay, so then how do you make these groupings from DNA?
So people have two special pieces of DNA, which we use to define two different kinds of haplogroups. The first kind is paternal haplogroups, traced through Y chromosomes, which get passed exclusively from fathers to sons. And the second kind is maternal haplogroups, traced through mitochondrial DNA, which gets passed from mothers to both sons and daughters.
Okay, then what makes these two pieces of DNA special?
So that's a great question. It's because the inheritance pattern is really simple, especially compared to the rest of your genome. And actually, the beginning of the word haplogroup, haplo, comes from the Greek word haplos, which means simple.
Oh, well, that's a good memory jogger.
Yeah. And so most of our DNA comes from a sort of random shuffling of our parents' DNA, which can make it difficult to figure out which side of the family each piece comes from.
Oh.
But then Y chromosomes and mitochondrial DNA don't get shuffled.
But then if they aren't shuffled, why aren't everyone's haplogroups exactly the same?
That's a great question. So over the more than 200,000 or so years of human evolution, the occasional DNA changes occurred and got passed on, creating new haplogroups.
Okay.
Okay, I have an analogy.
Okay.
So imagine a guy thousands of years ago, and this guy has a special recipe for his, you know, award-winning paleo soup.
Oh, okay.
And then he, along with his brothers, inherited this recipe from his dad, who got it from his dad, and all the men in the family faithfully stick to this recipe, no changes.
Ooh, well, I could go for some paleo soup right about now, but please, go on.
Yeah, this analogy always makes me hungry.
Okay, good.
And so then many generations later, you know, a great-great-great-grandson adds some cilantro.
Oh.
And then this great-great-grandson passes on a slightly modified version of this recipe to his sons, and all the men on his branch of the family tree start following this new cilantro recipe.
Oh.
And so now if you think about it, there are essentially two soup haplogroups. And this is pretty much how haplogroup inheritance works.
That makes a lot of sense. And since I'm a woman and I don't have a Y chromosome, how can I trace my paternal haplogroup?
Yeah, so what you can do is you can learn from relatives who share your paternal line. And so this would be something like a dad or a brother.
Okay, cool. So then what about the mother's side, the maternal haplogroups?
Right, you can trace this other kind of haplogroup through the DNA found in our cells' mitochondria, which turn the food we eat into usable energy for our cells.
Ah, the powerhouse of the cell.
You know your biology memes. So this mitochondrial DNA gets passed from moms to both sons and daughters.
Well, thanks, Mom. So how can we use haplogroups to trace our ancestry?
So closely related haplogroups tend to share geographic roots, and so scientists can use the kind of modern distributions of haplogroups around the world to trace some of these major migrations. And then these can help you understand where you fit into this ancient family tree of all humans.
Wow, I feel like the world has got a whole lot smaller. Thanks for being here, Samantha, and see you next time on the DNA Download.